Welcome back to another episode of Generation Films. My name is American Ben. So episode 3 of The Mandalorian really got things going with the action in the series. The final fight scenes make it clear that over the course of the series, we are going to witness Mr. Mandalorian kicking some serious assassin droids and stealing some Yoda babies. And along the way, the Mandalorian is going to upgrade his armor and weapons, and we're going to see the full capabilities of a Mandalorian on fire. Being that we've now seen the Mandalorian use a slew of different weapons and abilities, it might be worth going through and explaining what we've seen so far, along with giving some context relating to the history of Mandalorian weapons and armor. So that's exactly what we're going to do today. But first, I want to give a shout out to today's sponsor, Skillshare. Skillshare is an online learning community with thousands of classes covering dozens of creative and entrepreneurial skills. Want to learn how to do this? Okay, you probably need the Force for that. But Skillshare has an endless list of useful classes. Their lessons on video editing and do-it-yourself filmmaking have helped me become a better YouTuber. From graphic design to marketing to business skills and so on, Skillshare's learning community offers so much, and their premium membership gives you unlimited access, so you can join all of the classes that are right for you. Skillshare is also incredibly affordable, especially compared to in-person workshops. In other words, you can keep your Beskar, because an annual subscription to Skillshare is less than $10 a month. So please help support our channel and take advantage of this offer by clicking the link in the description box below. And when you do, you'll get 2 free months of Skillshare Premium. Okay, to start on the Mandalorian's arsenal, the Mandalorian, as all Mandalorians are bound to do by their creed, wears armor. At first, the Mandalorian wears some sort of basic metallic-based armor, probably a Durasteel composed alloy, which Mandalorians do wear at times, especially when they can't afford Beskar armor. When our junkie Mandalorian eventually trades his baby for spice money, he uses some of the Beskar to have full Beskar Mandalorian armor built. As we know, Beskar is Mandalorian iron, one of the most durable substances in the universe. Beskar is strong enough to deflect blaster fire, as we see when IG-11 shoots the pauldron on the Mandalorian's shoulder. Really, the only true threat to Beskar armor is the Arc Pulse Generator, a device invented by the legendary Mandalorian warrior Sabine Wren that the Empire employed as a weapon. The Arc Pulse Generator could disintegrate Mandalorians through their armor, but the armor would still be undamaged. So I'm not sure if that's a knock against Mandalorian armor or just Mandalorian skin. Historically, Mandalorian armor has often consisted of a T-shaped visor and helmet, shoulder pauldrons, a breastplate, codpiece, knee pads, thigh and shin guards, VAM braces, and a pair of boots. In the case of our baby-stealing Mandalorian, his armor is consistent with typical Mandalorian armor and comes fully loaded with the typical Mandalorian offensive weapons and gadgets, almost all of which were designed to combat the abilities of the Jedi. The Mandalorian wears a pair of VAM braces on his forearms that act as the brain of his suit. In the right VAM brace, he has a grappling line. He uses the grappling line for all sorts of things, from climbing to combat. I'm not sure about the ability of the line to auto-wind, because we usually see him pull or yank the line to do so, but it's possible it has that ability, and we just haven't really seen it yet. Mandalorians in general were known to use fiber cord whips, aka smart ropes launched from launchers on their wrists, to ensnare their enemies. The Mandalorian's whip has a grappling hook at the end that can latch onto objects. Oh, and the Mandalorian also has a flamethrower in his right VAM brace for lighting enemies on fire, letting Jawas know what's up, and also offers the Mandalorian the advantage of being able to cook up some delicious Kowakian monkey lizards. By the way, I know some people are bothered by people eating the Kowakians because they are an intelligent species, but remember, nothing is sentient after being grilled. The left VAM brace works more as the Mandalorian's data storage unit. There's some sort of computer technology in it that allows the Mandalorian to input information into it, including about bounty targets. After the Mandalorian upgrades his armor, he has Whistling Sparrows added to his left gauntlet as well. Whistling Sparrows, also known as Whistling Birds, were small cylindric explosive projectiles that flew through the air like homing missiles and exploded on impact, killing their target. And that's all we've seen from the Mandalorian's VAM braces so far, but we may see more as the series continues. Mandalorian VAM braces have been known to carry a plethora of other weapons and gadgets as well. For example, Mandalorians like Boba Fett had Dur-24 wrist lasers mounted on their left VAM braces that had the firepower of a standard blaster rifle and a range of up to 50 meters. Mandalorians, again such as Boba, also often had an MM9 mini concussion rocket launcher mounted on one of their gauntlets, And Mandalorian bounty hunters were also known to carry poison darts such as the Kamino saber dart. And though we haven't confirmed exactly how these were ejected, such darts were probably shot from the Mandalorian's Vam braces as well. After all, we do know that Sabine Wren housed paralyzing darts in her Vam braces. Mandalorian Vam braces were also known to contain repulsor lift technology that could repel enemies similar to the way Force Push could. Defensively, Mandalorian Vam braces sometimes housed personal combat shields as well. These plasma shields were often used by Night Owls, elite Mandalorian warriors within the Death Watch, a group of Mandalorians who advocated for returning Mandalorians to their violent crusader roots. In the Mandalorian's right boot, he houses a battle knife that he often uses for quick fatal blows in combat. He can use this knife in combination with his grappling line to pull enemies in and take them out. He may have a knife in his left boot as well, but I'm not sure about that. I'm just speculating based on the fact that he has wielded a blade with his left hand. Historically, Mandalorians have long been known for incorporating blades into their gear, such as Jango Fett with his retractable wrist blades. By the way, Mandalorian boots were typically magnetized, and I'm sure the same is true for the Mandalorian in this case. Finally, the Mandalorian used some sort of electric tool to cauterize a wound he sustained in an attack from a bunch of mercenaries looking to steal the Yoda baby. I'm not sure what the full abilities or proper use of this tool is, but it's likely just a simple gadget. Before we move on, we should point out that Mandalorians were known for having jetpacks equipped with their armor. Throughout their history, they have used a variety of different jetpacks, from the fast and well-armored Z6 to the more compact JT-12. Mandalorians used jetpacks in order to increase their mobility and competitiveness against the Jedi. Now on to the Mandalorian's firearms. The Mandalorian's main handgun was a blaster pistol based on the Earth gun, the Bergmann 1896, a late 19th century German semi-automatic pistol designed by Louis Schmeisser, the father of Hugo Schmeisser, the developer of the STG-44, the first widely used assault rifle. Historically, the Mandalorians used all sorts of handguns. The Westar series of pistols were some of the most common ones they used. The Westar 34 was a compact handgun made from DeLorean alloy, which made the weapon more heat-resistant than your standard blaster. The gun fired powerful bolts that were highly effective at close range. The Westar 35 was a weapon used by the Death Watch during the Clone Wars. The gun was often dual-wielded in combat and featured a stun setting for when the Death Watch didn't feel like killing. That setting was never used. The Mandalorian Blaster was a blaster used by the Mandalorians during the Mandalorian Wars, a galaxy-wide battle between the Mandalorians and the Galactic Republic that took place mostly in the 3960s BBY. The Mandalorian Heavy Blaster was a blaster created by the Mandalorians as an improvement on standard heavy blaster pistols. The gun was more powerful than standard heavy blasters, and some say that the weapon was capable of destroying a starship with a single shot, but the general consensus is that that is an exaggeration. The Mandalorian Disintegrator was the deadliest disruptor pistol in use during the time of the Dark Wars, a conflict between the Sith Empire and Galactic Republic that took place in the mid-3950s BBY. The gun fired energy bolts that could penetrate personal energy shields. Finally, the DE-10 blaster pistol was a blaster pistol heavily used by the Death Watch during the Galactic Civil War. The weapon fired blue laser bolts and had a range of 65 meters. The Mandalorian's main rifle was the Amban Sniper Rifle, also known as the Amban Phase Pulse Blaster, a weapon first seen used by Boba Fett in his own first appearance in Star Wars history. The Amban Sniper Rifle was a disruptor rifle that could be used as a conventional sniper rifle, firing solid slugs capable of disintegrating enemies. Historically, Mandalorian helmets contained all sorts of technology, such as macro binocular viewplates, antennas with rangefinders that could enhance the viewplate's imagery, tactical displays, comlinks, and sometimes even holo imagers in their rangefinders that could take snapshots. At one point, the Mandalorian uses his gun scope to track the client through a wall using infrared, and while he's doing this, he's able to listen to the client's conversation as well. This doesn't really tell us where the infrared is coming from. It's hard to tell if such technology is coming from the scopes themselves or whether the scopes just magnify the targets while the Mandalorian's helmet visor contains the infrared scanners. But it hints to us that his sniper rifle and helmet might be linked. Though that's not for sure, and he might just be schizophrenic and hearing voices in his head. In reality, the client was probably just trying to protect Baby Yoda and is actually a really nice guy. In addition to acting as a sniper rifle, the Amban also has a double prong on its front that can be used as a powerful taser. The weapon was super versatile and light enough to be used as a medium and short range shooter or even as a melee weapon. Historically, Mandalorians were much more into pistols, but they did use an assortment of rifles as well. The Mandalorian assault rifle was known for being extremely powerful for its size and featured a small scope. It was eventually modified into an assault blaster rifle by arms manufacturer Circa Corporation. Then there was the Death Watch blaster carbine, which was a larger variant of the Westar 35 blaster pistol. The carbine was used by the Mandalorian Guard and by the Death Watch during the Clone Wars. The Range Hunter EE-1 carbine rifle was a blaster carbine used by the Mandalorians during the revolt against the Eternal Empire in the 3630s BBY. Its successor, the EE-3 carbine rifle, was a blaster carbine that was the standard issue weapon of the Mandalorian Protectors, an organization of Mandalorian supercommandos who served as the Royal Guard to the Mandalorian ruler during the Clone Wars. The gun was fitted with a scope and was capable of 3-round burst fire at long range while having inferior accuracy and stopping power to larger rifles, as well as being more cut and halfable. Anyway, the point of going through all these weapons is to give you an idea about what we might see in the Mandalorian going forward. Though, as this series takes place long after much of Mandalorian written history, we may see lots of new stuff as well. Anyways, that's the Mandalorian's arsenal. He is pretty fully loaded. Remember to give this video a like if you did enjoy it. Comment down below, whatever the heck you want, because you are a bold individual YouTube commenting hero. Subscribe to our channel, hit that notification bell. For now, my name is American Ben, and I'll catch you next time. Generation Films, peace.